Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh dan selamat pagilah kepada Profesor Madia, Dr. Andri, Dr. Sim, kita ada Dr. Omar dan semua pelajar PSM 2. Adakah pelajar PSM 1 juga? Tapi untuk taklimat ni PSM 2 adalah diwajibkanlah untuk dengar taklimat berkenaan dengan PIAT. Sebab mungkin ada yang pertama kali dengar PIAT ni kan dan tak tahu apa e-report ni dengan technical paper ni sama ke tidak ke. Okay. So kita mulakan taklimat kita dengan umur kitab Al-Fatihah. Alright. Sebelum tu apa? Berkenaan dengan kita ada keluarkan JKPSM ada keluarkan satu memo. Itu memo yang ketiga berkenaan dengan penambahbaikan pentaksiran PSM lah. Ini sepatutnya supervisor ada bagi pada semua student dan dekat sini saya explain sikit lah berkenaan dengan penambahbaikan pentaksiran PSM ni di mana untuk PSM 2 kita sebelum ni pecahan dia adalah 70% daripada penyelia dan 30% daripada penilai. Tapi bagi start bermula pada semester 1 ni, iaitu 2021 dan 2022 ni, itu punya pecahan pentaksiran adalah sebanyak 60% daripada penyelia dan 40% daripada penilai, di mana e-report ni adalah sebanyak 15%. Kemudian kita ada technical paper sebanyak 15% dan pembentangan 10% dan total adalah 40% dah daripada penilai. Okay. Dan diingatkan jugalah sekiranya pelajar tidak menghantar technical paper, e-report, pembentangan mengikut tarikh yang ditetapkan iaitu untuk semester ni adalah 6 Januari 2022 kepada panel dan kepada supervisor pula adalah pada 30 Disember. Maka markah sebanyak 40% nanti akan ditolaklah. So kosong daripada 40% tu, maka kita tidak beri kepada pelajar PSM. Alright. So kena take note dan patuhi tarikh yang telah ditetapkan oleh JKPSM. Alright. So tu sajalah daripada saya. Kita boleh apa? Saya jemputlah Profesor Madia, Dr. Andri untuk menerangkan penggunaan dengan PIAT. Okay.
Dipersilakan. Terima kasih. Okay. Terima kasih, Dr. Dalila. Right. Assalamualaikum and very good morning, everyone. Just want to confirm you can hear my voice, kan?
Boleh.
Ada.
Okay, alright. So today, let me share my screen first. Okay, you can see my screen. The slide right now is showing the cover slide of my presentation today, the progress in engineering application and technology. Right, so I'm here. My name is Andri Kusbiantoro. You can call me Andri. Let's make this talk a casual one. Do not be too formal. Kalau ada soalan, you can raise your hand and I will try my best to answer your questions on the spot. Right, so I'm here representing the editorial team of PIAT, the progress in engineering application and technology. So the PIAT is the proceeding of our faculty, right? So as you know, we have several faculty in UTHM. Each of these faculties has their own proceeding. Okay, so actually the proceeding is not the intention of the faculty, it's coming from the direction of the top management, from the deputy vice chancellor in research, the TNCP, all right? So we want that every student that graduated from UTHM to have at least one research article published, one scientific article published online, all right? So these are one of the medium, all right? Okay, so since our faculty is quite big in terms of the scope. We have the civil, we have mechanical, we have electrical, we have transportation, and then we have chemical. So the PIAT itself consists of different editorial team. I think when you look at the guideline, PSM guideline, FYP guideline, you will see several names that are attached to each to each field, right? For example, if you have any problem with civil submissions, you can refer to me. You have a problem with electrical, mechanical, chemical, and the others, you can refer to the respective editor. We have our own team for your sections. Okay, so for today, I will take just a bit of your time. It's not going to take up to 2 hours, maybe from 30 to 40 minutes. It's not much, so I hope you can focus, right? Because I think this one taking 15 or 10% of your marks, if I'm not mistaken, right? So in here, I'm just going to highlight things that you should not do in PIAT, right? Because I believe you already got the briefing from your supervisor, you already got the briefing from many experts in report writing. So for today, I will just summarize all that you have done in the report into what are the things that you should not do for technical report, all right? So as you can see in the left, this is the report atau thesis, right? And this is the PIAT article. So these are two different entities, all right? Since these are two different entities, so you should treat them differently, okay? So when you want to submit to PIAT, the first thing that I need to highlight, PIAT has its own template, right? The latest template you can download from PIAT website, right? If currently you have the template in your hand, let's say the PIAT proceeding version 1 atau version 2, then you need to download the latest one in PIAT website. Now we are using the version 3. The version 3 has the ISN number on the top of the first page, all right? So if your version doesn't have any the ISN number, right? ISSN number, so it means you're not holding the latest template. You have to go to PIAT website and download the latest one, right? So when talking about the template, first rule, never change the PIAT template, not even the font type, right? You have to treat your template, the PIAT template, like your brand new car. Okay, contohnya awak baru upgrade kereta awak, you beli kereta Honda, favorite graduan, kereta Honda, brand new Civic, right? So keep it standard. Sampai let's say awak jumpa your new boyfriend atau your new girlfriend, and then you want to impress them, awak tukar spoiler. Tambahkan spoiler, tambahkan stiker, tambahkan benda-benda mengarut tu, then mungkin you want to impress them. You can impress them. But since I'm not your girlfriend, I'm not your boyfriend, and you don't have to impress me, so keep it standard. Jangan tukar apa-apa. Saya suka yang just as it is, right? The template just as it is. You just have to change the content. So what does it mean with changing the first one? Saya bagi contoh yang student selalu buat. Dia tukar dekat atas. For example, at the left side, showing the template, the current template. Believe me, once you submit the article, I will receive the changing format like this. All right? You suddenly you change to Comic Sans, atau you change to different fonts. Okay? We don't want it. Right? Keep the template standard. Right. So the next one, I know sometimes you copy the content of your technical report from the thesis, from the e-report, right? I don't mind with that, right? I really don't mind with that, even though I'm encouraging you to rephrase some of the sentences, right? But of course, most of the time, you will take the content from the report, and I'm okay with that. But when you copy and paste from the report, never copy and paste blindly from the thesis, from the report, all right? What does it mean with copy and paste blindly? You copy the article, you highlight from chapter one, you copy, and then you bang, you put into the technical report. Never do it that way, because it means you will bring the format, right? The safest one, when you click paste, always differentiate the keep source formatting, merge formatting, and keep text only. The safest bet you can go is by keep text only. All right, so you, let's say this is the template of your PAD. You paste and then click over here at the last sentence and keep text only. Paste as a keep text only. And then you delete the remaining from the template. All right, that's how to make sure the template doesn't alter that much. All right, I hope you can put this in your mind, because I believe you will copy and paste, trust me. But when you copy and paste, try to keep the text only. Or if you want to be safe, you open in the notepad, paste in the notepad first, and then from the notepad, you copy into the technical report. That's the safest, the safest procedure. Right, okay, section break. Section break is the one that we hate so much, the team editor, the editorial team. Because why? If you copy blindly from the thesis, from the report, you will include section break. Right, maybe some of you never use section break before, it's okay. But some of you already master the Microsoft Word, you will notice that section break is very useful when you want to change the paging, right? When you want to change the paging, you want to change format into totally different from the first or from the previous page, then you use section break. But in PAD, we don't have section break, right? So if you put section break, it will change the formatting entirely. Then kita kena tukar satu persatu, right? So if let's say normally one article when we do the copy editing will take up to 15 minutes, but because of the section break, then the time taken will be 1 hour. If we have 300 article, so you can imagine how many time we have to spend to edit your article one by one, right? So I really ask you, right? Saya really mohon, forget about the section break. Unless you really hate me, you betul-betul tak suka saya, maybe my FYP student, you tak suka saya, you benci saya, pasal you nak seksa saya, you masuk section break. Okay, that's a very good way to torture me. But if you really want to, do not to torture me, please omit the section break. Okay, just keep the section break in your thesis, not in PAD article. Okay, kita tak nak semua ini. Right, so you tengok balik nanti dalam technical report, right? Okay, yang keempat, the use of text wrapping. Okay, whenever possible, kalau kalian notice, anytime you nak paste a chart, anytime you nak paste figure, try to use inline with text. Right, sometimes you tak nak pening, you tekan je enter, provide space, lepas tu you put in front of text. Itu nanti kalau let's say ada changes from the previous page, dalam technical report awak akan jadi macam ni. Kita dah confused. Kat mana letaknya figure ni? Right. So, try your best untuk pakai inline with text. If you're using inline with text also, it's easier for you to manage, easier for me to manage as well. Okay. Always treat your figure and table as part of the main text, bukan sebagai alien yang dia melayang dekat atas teks atau dekat belakang teks. No, the figure and table is part of your main text. Always treat them like that. Right? Okay. You forgot to put the in-text citations. Ini pening. Sebab dalam reference kalian letak 10. Tapi dalam paper tak ada langsung. Hanya 2 atau 3 je. Itu pening. Kita kena trace satu-satu, memang tak mungkin lah. So big probably kita akan reject. Right, kalau ada 10 references, waktu ada 5 je dalam main text. Itu memang tak tally. So every time awak nak letak references, pastikan dia tally in the main text. Right? Simple rule of thumb, if it is other people opinion, put the citations. Okay, contohnya kalian ambil opinion dari orang lain, based on Kusbiantoro et al, the analysis show that blah blah blah. It's the other people opinion. So you have to put the citations. If it's other people data, you have to put the citation. Contohnya awak nak compare data awak dengan data orang lain. So you have to put the citation on that data. right? Tapi kalau it's a common and shared knowledge among your expertise, then it's not necessary to put citation. Contohnya, matahari terbit dari timur, nah, tak payah letak citations. Right, satu hari ada 24 jam, tak payah letak citations. Atau kalau special, the function of engine oil is to lubricate the running of the piston, for example. Then, tak perlu letak citations. Atau concrete is made from cement, water, and fine aggregate. Tak perlu letak citation. It's a common knowledge. Kita share knowledge itu sama-sama dengan orang lain. Right. Unless kalau awak berasal dari mungkin 300 tahun yang lepas, where no one know what is the function of engine oil, then you can put citation for that. Tapi kalau ini common, tak perlu. Right. So check your technical paper later on, because I believe you have done correctly in report. Tapi masa kalian copy and paste, terlupa. Most of the case adalah terlupa. Itu masalah yang klasik lah. And then, satu yang last. Try not to produce a technical paper that is 100% identical to your full report. Okay. So, bezakan ya, report, you ada chapter 1 kan? You ada chapter 1, you ada background, problem statement, objective. Jangan letak itu dalam technical report. So, dalam technical report, paling sesuai letak aja background. Alright, lepas background, kalau kalian perlu letak objektif, letak dekat the last paragraph of that background. Okay, lepas background, terus masuk metodologi. Tak payah letak 2 literature review, 2.1 literature review pasal apa, tak perlu. Right, keep it in your report. So kalau kalian nak letak literature review, letak dekat background. Dah cukup. Right, so background supposed to consist of your problem statement, a bit of literature review, and your objective. Itu je. So satu part tu background dah comprise of your chapter 1. Right. Nanti yang kedua masuk methodology. Ketiga masuk ke result and discussion. Empat conclusion. Dah finish. That is the technical report. Now most of the time your senior akan letak satu introduction, lepas tu dua problem statement, tiga objektif, tak nak. Kita tak nak macam tu. Sebab technical report is not thesis. Right, technical report is like what the But technical report is like the summary of the whole thesis. Right? So do not blindly copy from your thesis. Just the summary. Okay? Sebab thesis awak 50 pages. Nak copy semua memang tak mungkin lah. Kalau ada soalan, seberapa muka surat yang optimum untuk technical report? I will say from 6 to 10. Itu dah cukup. Tak nak lah kita sampai 20 pages. Nak cakap apa 20 pages tu? Most of the time adalah review. Unless your paper is a review article, then mungkin. Tapi kalau your paper is a technical report, 6 to 10 is already sufficient. Okay. Alright. And then dekat muka surat yang paling depan. Let me go previous. Okay. Okay, dekat sini. Alright. Dekat sini tak perlu letak title. Right, dekat nama ni. So tak kisahlah USB ada doktor, tak ada doktor, dia ada profesor, tak ada profesor, ada haji, tak ada haji, letak nama sahaja. Right. Write only their full names. Kalau kalian nak omit bin atau binti pun boleh. Right, sebab nanti kalau kita letak bin atau binti, sometimes dia captured as the middle name. Right. So ingat tu, hanya tulis nama kalian sahaja. Siapa nama pertama? For me is the student name. Right. I prefer nama saya ditulis last. Right. So let's say supervisor, orang dah tahu dah, oh yang pertama mesti student, yang last tu mesti supervisor. Right. Tapi sometimes mungkin kalian akan jumpa SB yang minta untuk ditulis nama dia dulu. So you discuss with them lah. Right. But for me, the most suitable one supposed to be the student name. Right, nanti masa dapat award, let's say your article tercalon untuk dapat award, dapat hadiah. you yang akan dapat hadiah, bukan your supervisor. Alright? Okay, yang ni pasal acknowledgement. Alright, pasal acknowledgement, keep it simple. Alright, keep it simple, keep it concise. Kalau kalian tak tahu nak tulis apa, follow je yang template tu. Okay. Tak perlu kalian letak, I want to thank, kalau kalian tengok dalam report, satu page kan, acknowledgement kalian. You want to thank your parents, you want to thank your laptop, you want to thank your gaming friends, you want to thank your girlfriend, you want to thank your boyfriend, you want to thank your pets, your cats, your dogs, all you want to thank. But in technical report, since it's going to be read by someone else, right, in your field, maybe your junior, maybe your supervisor friends, they don't really want to know who you want to thank for, right? And never put your supervisor name at the acknowledgement. Because why? Your supervisor is in the author list. Maksudnya nama supervisor awak ada dekat depan tu. Dia menulis artikel tu. So jangan pernah thank the supervisor in the acknowledgement list. Sebab kenapa? Maknanya kalau awak tulis nama SB awak dalam acknowledgement, SB awak thank himself atau themselves. I don't think your SB nak buat macam tu kan. So keep it simple. You nak thank your technician, okay. You nak thank the UTSM for providing facilities, okay. Selalunya, you kena tanya your SB, mereka ada nombor grant tak? Itu paling penting. Kita tak nak tahu your CATS contribution to your technical report. Kita nak tahu apakah research awak ni, kajian awak ni, is being funded by the grant, certain grant, right? Because your SV can claim that article as the outcome of your grant, of his grant. Right? So always ask your supervisor nak letak nombor grant tak? Kalau letak, you minta dengan tajuk. Lepas tu siapa fundernya? Okay? Keep in mind on that. Right, and then header and footer. Okay, header and footer ada yang sebagian tukar entirely. Okay, jangan eh. So yang pertama, kalian hanya perlu tukar bagian ini saja. Ini first page. Corresponding author sepatutnya adalah SB awak. Siapa yang ada asterisk? Dalam nama tu ada asterisk. So contohnya saya, corresponding author, selepas Andrikus Biantoro ada asterisk. And then put my email over here. Put your SV email. Sebab kenapa nanti kalau ada orang nak refer, alright? Ada orang nak refer paper tu, dia boleh tanya SV awak. Kalau dia tanya awak, mungkin awak dah busy kerja. Alright? So dia boleh tanya SV awak. So corresponding author, letak your SV name. Awak ambillah first author. Alright? And then page one. Okay, nampak tak ada line kat sini? Jangan delete line tu. Line tu ada kat sana memang kita letak. Bukan suka-suka letak. So, jangan delete. Hanya tukar email je. Contohnya email SB awak, andri@utsm.edu.my. Okay. And then page 1 and page 2, kalau kalian perasan, dia ada sebelah kiri dan kanan. Jangan tukar. Alright. So, kalian perlu tukar author 1 ni nama awak. Alright, sebab tu orang selalu nak nama depan kan. Letak nama saya kat depan, letak nama saya kat depan. Actually, sebab every time kita cite paper, nama orang yang pertama tu yang selalunya famous. Right. So yang ini letak nama awak, author 1. Your last name. So kalau contohnya nama awak Andrikus Biantoro, Kus Biantoro et al. Yang ini biarkan. Sorry, yang ini volume 3, number 1, 2022 supposedly, alright? This one, 2022. Page, biarkan. Page nanti kita yang akan tukar. Alright? Ada soalan tak setakat ni? Okay, tak ada. Alright, yang ini pasal content. Saya bagi suggestion je. Some students tend to use long passive sentence. Sebab kita dah terbiasa diajar passive sentence tu look smart, looks formal, kan? Tapi itu style lama. Right? Style sekarang ni kita pakai active sentence. Right? Kemudian kita short kan. Right? Contohnya dekat sini saya bagi contoh eh. Dia satu sentence 39 perkataan. Kalau awak baca penat. Right? For example, economists considered AirAsia a large low-cost airline corporation founded in 1993 by DRB Highcom before it was bought by Tony Fernandez and Kamarudin Mehranoon in 2001 to be a model in the development of modern low-cost airline industry worldwide. One short, one long breath. Right? Very penat baca ini. So imagine dalam technical report tu ada benda ini dari muka surat awal sehingga akhir. So penatlah panel yang baca. So saya suggest try to break down. Right? For example, economists consider AirAsia to be a model in the development of modern low-cost airline industry worldwide. Right? Active sentence. DRB Highcom founded this large low-cost airline operation in 1993. Active sentence, short. It was then bought by Tony Fernandez and Kamarudin Mehranoon in 2001. Only then you can put the passive. So decomposition is like 70% to 30%. The best one, I can say lah. Right? So you look back your thesis, you look back your report, and try to make some amendments if necessary. Okay? Right, so if you have let's say 10 words in one sentence, orang lagi senang paham tu 95%. 20 perkataan, 80% faham. Tapi kalau dah 30, dia dah turun. Drastically ke 60% sahaja. 50, 50%. Maksudnya dah confused. Awak nak sampaikan apa? Awak nak cerita pasal apa? Kan? Right. Ada soalan ke? Tak ada. And then do not use word that do not add value to your idea. Ini student suka buat. Contohnya, it is well known that. It is worth mentioning that. Kalau you boleh delete perkataan tu, right, dan maknanya tak berubah, maknanya you tak perlukan perkataan tu. Right, straightforward je. Ya ini buat penat baca je. It is well known that apa functionnya? It is worth mentioning that. Tak ada functions. Delete je. Okay, you start directly to straightforward to the one that you want to explain. Right? Kalau saya suka pakai grammar checking software, Grammarly. So, kalau you nak, you mungkin boleh buat crowdfunding satu kelas ke, kalau ada 30 orang, seorang RM10, you boleh pakai sama-sama. Right? So, maybe you want to invest in this grammar checking software. Okay, the last part. Everything, every submissions must be done through PAYAT system. So apa yang kena buat? Awak kena register dulu di website ni. Right? Masuk ke website ni, you type je dekat Google, publisher, UTSM, PAYAT. Alright, you type je dekat Google macam tu, dia akan keluar link ke PAYAT ni. You register, and the next step, you boleh refer to the PSM guideline. Saya dah letak step by step how to register, how to submit, and how to everything. Okay? So, make sure you not wrongly register to the wrong proceeding. Sebab kita ada 10 proceeding last time. I think sekarang dah tambah 11. Kita ada 11 proceeding in PSM. Sorry? Okay. Kita ada I think 10 atau 11 prosedur dalam UTSM. So jangan silap register to PAYAT. Right. After you register, you follow the step by step guideline given by the JK PSM. Okay, already comprehensive over there. Okay, itu je dari saya. Ada soalan tak?